Greetings. Now it's important of our study of the protocols that we know the root of it. But this is a different version of the elders of the protocols of Zion, but it gives the root. And I always remember that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad told you the root of the Caucasian. And he also explained to us that all Caucasians are Jews, but they all don't know their origin and who they are. Just like the black man. The black man don't know he's a god. He's the original man, the tribe of Shabazz. So without any further talk, let's get it on.
Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion. Translated by Victor E. Marsden. Table of Contents. Visiting the Protocols. Protocol 1, the Basic Doctrine. Protocol 2, Economic Wars. Protocol 3, Methods of Conquest. Protocol 4, Materialism Replaces Religion. Protocol 5, Despotism and Modern Progress. Protocol 6, Takeover Technique. Protocol 7, Worldwide Wars. Protocol 8, Provisional Government. Protocol 9, Re-education. Protocol 10, Preparing for Power. Protocol 11, The Totalitarian State. Protocol 12, Control of the Press. Protocol 13, Distractions. Protocol 14, Assault on Religion. Protocol 15, Ruthless Suppression. Protocol 16, Brainwashing. Protocol 17, Abuse of Authority. Protocol 18, Arrest of Opponents. Protocol 19, Rulers and People. Protocol 20, Financial Program. Protocol 21, Loans and Credit. Protocol 22, Power of Gold. Protocol 23, Instilling Obedience. Protocol 24, Qualities of the Ruler. Preface, translated by Victor E. Marsden. The author of this translation of the famous protocols was himself a victim of the revolution. He had lived for many years in Russia and was married to a Russian lady. Among his other activities in Russia, he had been for a number of years a Russian correspondent of the Morning Post, a position which he occupied when the revolution broke out, and his vivid descriptions of events in Russia will still be in the recollection of many of the readers of that journal. Naturally, he was singled out for the anger of the Soviet. On the day that Captain Cromie was murdered by Jews, Victor Marsden was arrested and thrown into the Peter Paul prison, expecting every day to have his name called out for execution. This, however, he escaped, and eventually he was allowed to return to England, very much of a wreck in bodily health. However, he recovered under treatment and the devoted care of his wife and friends. One of the first things he undertook, as soon as he was able, was this translation of the protocols. Mr. Marsden was eminently well qualified for the work. His intimate acquaintance with Russia, Russian life and the Russian language on the one hand, and his mastery of a terse literary English style on the other, placed him in a position of advantage which few others could claim. The consequence is that we have in his version an eminently readable work, and though the subject matter is somewhat formless, Mr. Marsden's literary touch reveals the thread running through the 24 protocols. It may be said with truth that this work was carried out at the cost of Mr. Marsden's own life's blood. He told the writer of this preface that he could not stand more than an hour at a time of his work on it in the British Museum, as the diabolical spirit of the matter which he was obliged to turn into English made him positively ill. Mr. Marsden's connection with the Morning Post was not severed by his return to England, and he was well enough to accept the post of special correspondent of that journal in the suite of HRH, the Prince of Wales, on his Empire tour. From this he returned with the Prince, apparently in much better health, but within a few days of his landing he was taken suddenly ill, and died after a very brief illness. May this work be his crowning monument. In it he has performed an immense service to the English-speaking world, and there can be little doubt that it will take its place in the first rank of the English versions of the Protocols of the Meetings of the Learned Elders of Zion. Introduction. Of the protocols themselves little need be said in the way of introduction. The book in which they are embodied was first published in the year 1897 by Philip Stepanov for private circulation among his intimate friends. The first time Nilus published them was in 1901 in a book called The Great Within the Small and reprinted in 1905. A copy of this is in the British Museum bearing the date of its reception, August 10, 1906. All copies that were known to exist in Russia were destroyed in the Kerensky regime, and under his successors the possession of a copy by anyone in Soviet land was a crime sufficient to ensure the owners of being shot on sight. The fact is in itself sufficient proof of the genuineness of the protocols. The Jewish journals, of course, say that they are a forgery, leaving it to be understood that Professor Nilus, who embodied them in a work of his own, had concocted them for his own purposes. Mr. Henry Ford, in an interview published in the New York World, February 17, 1921, put the case for Nilus tersely and convincingly thus, "The only statement I care to make about the protocols is that they fit in with what is going on. They are 16 years old, and they have fitted the world situation up to this time. They fit in now, indeed they do. The word protocol signifies a précis gummed onto the front of a document, a draft of a document, minutes of proceedings. In this instance, protocol means minutes of the proceedings of the meetings of the learned elders of Zion. These protocols give the substance of addresses delivered to the innermost circle of the rulers of Zion. They reveal the converted plan of action of the Jewish nation developed through the ages and edited by the elders themselves up to date. Parts and summaries of the plan have been published from time to time during the centuries as the secrets of the elders have leaked out. The claim of the Jews that the protocols are forgeries is in itself an admission of their genuineness, for they never attempt to answer the facts corresponding to the threats which the protocols contain, and, indeed, the correspondence between prophecy and fulfillment is too glaring to be set aside or obscured. This the Jews well know and therefore evade. Captain A.H.M. Ramsey records in his classic, The Nameless War, according to a letter published in Plain English, a weekly review published by the North British Publishing Co. and edited by the late Lord Alfred Douglas, on the 3rd of September 1921, the learned elders have been in existence for a much longer period than they have perhaps suspected. My friend, Mr. L.D. van Valkert, of Amsterdam, has recently sent me a letter containing two extracts from the synagogue at Mulheim. The volume in which they are contained was lost at some period during the Napoleonic Wars, and has recently come into Mr. van Valkert's possession. It is written in Genem, and contains extracts of letters sent and received by the authorities of the Mulheim Synagogue. The first entry he sends me is of a letter received, the 16th of June 1647. From O.C., i.e. Oliver Cromwell, by Ebenezer Pratt. In return for financial support will advocate admission of Jews to England, this however impossible while Charles living."
You always gotta go to the root. Now this language might be too complicated for y'all to understand on some level, but we're trying to get to the root. And always remember that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad always said that Jews are the first to come out the caves. They're taught civilization by Moses, also taught technology by Moses, that was carried over from Yaqub in the making of the devil. Now it's important that we get to the root of what's going on right now. All you got to do is look around you, look on the television, look at what's going on. We got upon us right now a pandemic. No one is asking the question, how did it get on us, come on us? How, is it man-made? Is it a war weapon? But before we go, we want to remind you of this history of the black man.
The Willie Lynch Letter, The Making of a Slave. This speech was delivered by Willie Lynch on the bank of the James River in the colony of Virginia in 1712. Lynch was a British slave owner in the West Indies. He was invited to the colony of Virginia in 1712 to teach his methods to slave owners there. The term lynching is derived from his last name. December 25th, 1712. Gentlemen, I greet you here on the bank of the James River in the year of our Lord 1712. First, I shall thank you, the gentlemen of the colony of Virginia, for bringing me here. I am here to help you solve some of your problems with slaves. Your invitation reached me on my modest plantation in the West Indies, where I have experimented with some of the newest and still the oldest methods for control of slaves. Ancient Romans would envy us if my program is implemented. As our boat sailed south on the James River, named for our illustrious king, whose version of the Bible we cherish, I saw enough to know that your problem is not unique. While Rome used cords of wood as crosses for standing human bodies along its highways in great numbers.